How about we all stand together and let's come before the Lord in prayer and just invite his spirit to do his thing. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, we praise you, God. We thank you, Lord, just for delivering us from ourselves, from our sin, from our shame, from our burdens. And Lord, just giving us your grace and your mercy, shedding your blood for us. I thank you, God. Lord, I just pray that you would take this time of worship. I pray that you would be magnified, that you would be glorified, that you would be placed upon the throne of our hearts, God, that you would take your rightful place in our lives, Lord. Father, I pray that you would come before our plans, our trials, our worries. God, that you would be first in our lives and in our hearts, God. So, Lord, be magnified and praised right now. Your will be done, Lord. Your will be done. We praise you, God. We thank you, Jesus. Amen.
I see the King of Glory.
As on that ancient day, songs of enduring love, and then your glory came. And as a sign in you that we will love the same, our hearts will sing that song. God, let your glory come. Let's lift it up. For you are good, you are good. On that ancient day. lifted up. You are good. You are good. You are good. And your love endures. You are good. You are good. And your love endures. You are good. You are good. And your love endures
Please.
tremble in fear because they know that you hold the power. You hold the victory, God. You've claimed it. You are our champion. We thank you, God. We praise you. Father, may we never forget that you are powerful, God. You are creator of the heavens and the earth. How awesome you are that you can help us. You offer your hand to us. And you say, ask me. Father, teach us to be your children, unafraid, but brave and courageous, because you are power. You are our defender and our deliverer. Open our eyes, God. Open our hearts, Lord Jesus, that we may hear what you have to say to us this morning, God. We praise you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't you guys turn around and say hello to someone?
Get away.
Okay. If anybody can grab their seats. I'd like to welcome everybody. My name is John Pierre. I'd like to welcome you guys to Calvary Chapel. Glad you guys made it here today. Amazing seeing everybody's faces. I love it coming up here every week. Just seeing everybody looking amazing as always. So I got some announcements for you guys. If you guys can keep your attention to the board. We got Monday nights, we have men's study. We're going through the Truth Project, and the Truth Project about that, that's about just things about life. We're gonna go very in depth. Every week is something different. This week, I believe it's philosophers and just people who said stuff and the truth about that. And it's really life-changing a lot. It just shows everything about life that you might not like know. So if men, you're interested, it starts at 7 o'clock, and women as well. There's also a study for you guys. Also at church at 7 o'clock, you guys are going through a book, I believe. And if you guys have any questions about men's study, you could see me, Mr. Sean, Mr. Claudio, and women, if you're interested as well, you can see Miss Roz, Miss Loy, and Shannon's not here, but you guys would see her if she was. So that's that. And then women, you guys are going on a retreat pretty soon, I believe. We're having a fundraiser next week, actually. And you guys are going to go to Mount Hermon, a very beautiful place that I would recommend a lot. You guys will like it a lot. So women, if you're interested in that, again, see Crystal or Shannon or Miss Jasmine for any further information. And then this is actually in the past, so I'm not going to announce that. If we could just skip that one. And then actually, cool, Jason, I don't know if anybody's checked it out yet, but we have a new website for Calvary Chapel. Go to calvarychapelsanmateo.com. You'll check it out, get everything you guys want to know, announcements, service times, just anything coming up. Just a lot of cool stuff on that if you guys want to check that out. We have a mobile app coming out soon too, so just keep your fingers crossed, make sure that doesn't bail on us, but yeah. And then if anybody's looking to help out, you could come like maybe 15 minutes earlier, just help us set up chairs, communion, just anything. We can really use the extra hand around here. Sometimes it's a little hard. People are doing like 5-7 things at a time, and we're a church, we're a family, we're supposed to help each other out. So if you guys are interested, I'm not pushing you guys, but if you guys are interested, just come see me. We have a little backup table in the back, and then pray on it. If you guys want to help out, we'd really admire it. And then some of the stuff we can do is like the bread run. Like in every Saturday morning, we go get bread from Safeway, who kindly donates it to us, that we bring here to the church to give out to you guys to take out throughout the week, and we donate it to other people as well. So that's one of the many things that you guys can do. Greeters and ushers, just stand by the door, give a big warm welcome, big smile to everybody walking through the door, and welcome to the home. So just stuff like that, small things, nothing like big heavy lifting or anything like that. So don't get too scared, but yeah. And then this is pretty cool, Operation Christmas Child coming up. Let's give that a hand. That's something pretty good. What that is, I don't know if nobody's ever done it, I'll explain a little briefly on it. It's we just make little gifts for places that we send everywhere around the world. Like you can, anything, toys, toothbrushes, clothes, socks, just anything. It doesn't have to be big, doesn't have to be anything, could be dollar things, 25-cent things, just anything these kids get, they take open-heartedly and open-handedly. So we have all the brochures and all the flyers and stuff back in the back table. If you guys just take as much as you want. If you guys have any other questions, you can see Jasmine. She's in charge of that. So that's coming up soon. So let's jump on in and get as much as we can so we can bless these kids. And I believe that.
Let's just skip that.
Let's just skip that one. Okay, let's give it up for Jay teaching you guys.
Good morning, everyone. Jason Fry, our pastor, is away on vacation. He went up to Seattle to just have some sweet fellowship with Christina and Matt Abed. Some of you know them, so our thoughts and prayers go with them. This morning, we're going to be continuing our study through the book of John. If you guys have your Bibles, you can turn to John chapter 3, we're going to be in verses 22 through chapter 4, verse 3. One last order of business, if you guys have a cell phone, you can put on silent or vibrate. That'd be stupendous. With that, let's pray, and let's see what the Lord has for us this morning. Father, we come wanting to hear from your word. Lord, needing to hear you. Lord, for you to show us more of yourself, to be instructed by you, Lord, to be empowered, to be comforted, to be encouraged and exhorted. So, Lord, I thank you for this passage of Scripture, Lord, for John the Baptist, Lord, and his example, his heart. And, Lord, I pray that that heart would be in us. Lord, that you would increase and that we would decrease. So we give you this time. We ask that you be the speaker this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So before we jump into John 3, there's some background. Since we're going to be looking at John the Baptist, that I just want to highlight and focus in on. And remember that John is writing, John, the Apostle John is writing this epistle that we would believe. That's the series that we've been going through. The reason that, and the premise for which John is writing is that you would believe, that you would know that Jesus is the Son of God. So, part of that is a witness of John the Baptist. So John, again, the Apostle John, in his writings, he's already kind of touched on John the Baptist and his witness. And what's interesting is here in John 3, he circles back to him. There's like a little inside tidbit. It's kind of like sometimes in sports they talk about how there's this insider. Like, oh, he's the insider. He's in the locker room, or he's close to the, and you get these little tidbits about the athletes. Or maybe you guys are watching like the extended features on a movie you got, and you find out that there's some of these interactions that you wouldn't normally see, or you just normally get from the movie, of how directors are working, and it's like a picture inside that you get to see. And that's what this is. No other gospel records. John, the Apostle John, he has a lot of original material. And so he wants to circle back and show us something about John the Baptist in his heart here. But again, starting with John and giving some background on him. First, he was a miracle baby. I mean, he was born to elderly parents. They were not expecting to have a son. The time had passed, and boom, God gives him. He was a miracle. He was a gift, and that was known. He was born into a priestly family. He grew up around the temple. This was the temple was the center of worship on earth for the Lord. I mean, so he is like religious place center, you know, and he's growing up. He's a gift from God, and we're all children are gifts from God, but I mean, just, it was just a miracle, and there's probably, maybe some expectation of him, or just some sense that, wow, there's something that God's going to do with him. And he's in and around the temple. He's being trained. So that's his upbringing. But at some point, he moves to the desert. And we get a picture of who he is after that. He decides, hey, I'm going to follow the Lord, and he goes out to the desert. And there we find that he's wearing a camel's hair tunic, and he's eating locusts. You know, needless to say, he was probably not trying to win the popularity contest at school. I don't think the camel's hair, although those big leather belts are coming back in, or they're back in, but you know, wasn't the fashion at the time. So that's who he was. You know, he wasn't like trying to fit in so much. As a matter of fact, it was the opposite. When the religious leader, the people that mattered, quote unquote, that carried power, that carried weight, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the priests, who he'd probably grown up around, these people that were in charge of some level of government, the charge in some level of the religion and just the culture there, when they would come, I mean, he would be like, brood of vipers. He would just call a spade a spade. He'd be like, straight up, look, who warned you guys of the wrath to come? He wasn't afraid about ruffling feathers. He was going to be God's man. And it wasn't just the religious leaders, the religious hypocrites. I mean, he called out a king. I believe it's Philip, or no, it's Herod. And Herod had an adulterous relationship with Philip's wife, and he calls it out. I mean, that's like, I mean, well, it led to him getting thrown in prison and ultimately executed. So an idea of who John was, you know, he was, look, I'm not worried about those things. I'm worried about the truth. I'm worried about what God has for me. We know something else about John in chapter 1 that he didn't just arbitrarily decide to go out to the desert, start putting on some weird clothing and eating locusts. It was that he was called. He was called by God to do a special work, to be that voice crying out in the wilderness to prepare the way for the Lord. Now, to be called and to be obedient to that call, you have to be listening for a call. And that's something that we see about John and his background. This is a guy that was listening for the Lord. He was, we can be challenged by that. You know, sometimes, especially here in this area, we could become so busy that we tend not to leave room to hear from the Lord. But the Lord is speaking. He does have a plan in our lives. He has a plan in your life, a specific thing for you to do. Jason, last week, he touched on Ephesians 2:10, that there are good works for all of us, each and every one of us, to walk in, that we are his workmanship. And God is speaking. He's speaking to each and every one of us. But are we listening? John was. John was listening. And he went out. And he went out and he did something that was unpopular. And so the last thing that also is touched on in John, the Gospel of John chapter 1, is that he had his critics. And that's going to happen. Anytime you stand up and obey the Lord, there's going to be some critics. There's going to be some feathers ruffled. Because God's way is not the world's way. John didn't mind. So, all of that brings us to the background of where we are here in verse 22. So I'm going to read verse 22 through 30. After these things, Jesus and his disciples came into the land of Judea, and there he remained with them and baptized. Now John was also baptizing in Enon near Salim, because there was much water there. And they came and were baptized, for John had not been thrown into prison. Not yet, at least. Verse 25, then there arose a dispute between some of John's disciples and the Jews regarding purification. And they came to John, that is John the Baptist, and said, Rabbi, he who is with you beyond the Jordan, and it's more of like an accusing thing. He's like, hey, Rabbi, you know he that was with you beyond the Jordan, to whom you have testified? Behold, he is baptizing, and all are coming to him. And John answered and said, hey, a man can receive nothing unless it's been given to him from heaven. You yourselves bear witness that I said that I am not the Christ, but that I have been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom. There's only one person getting married, or there's two people getting married. There's the groom and the bride. And the friend, the best man, you know, he stands and hears the groom, and he rejoices greatly at the groom's voice. Therefore, this is my joy. My joy is fulfilled in this. Hey, he must increase and I must decrease. I love John's heart, and that's that heart right there, and that what John says right there, that's the heart that really encompasses every day of our walk, at least what it should be. That's the heart of Christianity, that we're decreasing and that the Lord is increasing in us, and it's so awesome to see. But let's go back up to verse 22. After these things, Jesus and his disciples came into the land. After what things? What has happened? To get an idea of the context of what we've talked about, we opened the first chapter where the Apostle John, he starts with his own profession. Remember, this is written that we would believe in Jesus. So he starts with his own profession and giving that Jesus being the word that is from the beginning, that word that is from God, that word being God, and that word becoming flesh and dwelling among us. He then jumps straight into Jesus' first public witness. He gives that first initial story about John the Baptist, Jesus coming to the Jordan. John the Baptist is there. And John the Baptist goes, behold, this is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. This first public pointing to Jesus. In John chapter 2, we see that there's a beginning of Jesus' public ministry with his first miracle, that there's water being turned into wine, that even his family, his mother, is encouraging him, and that there's something special about this guy. I mean, the book of John is written in such a way in that it starts and it climaxes. You know, and they're just giving more reasons. Look, you need to believe in Jesus. Look, he is the Word from the beginning. He's come. He's here. His first miracle is John the Baptist, who is, you know, he's laid the way for him. His mother believed in him. It brings us to John 3, where Nicodemus, look, even Nicodemus came and said, look, Jesus, we know that you are from God. And we talked about that in chapter 3, about being born again. We're given insight in John 3 to Jesus' message, the message that we're to put our trust in, that we'd be born again. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And in John 3:18, this is Jesus' message that our default, humanity's default position is being condemned already without God. That we need to believe. The invitation is to whoever, but where we're starting from, how we're born, and Jason touched on that 2 weeks ago, that how we're born is condemned already, born into sin. So, all of that brings us to after these things. All those things have now happened. And his disciples came into the land of Judea. So they're in Jerusalem. They go out to Judea. And in verse 22, he remained with them there and was baptizing. Now, to clear up the picture of what's happening here, is in chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, we find out that Jesus actually wasn't doing the baptizing. It was his disciples. So a picture in your mind of what is happening here is they go out and they're baptizing, but it's not Jesus. It's like the disciples are baptizing, and Jesus is really, his presence being there and him receiving the disciples, he's giving authority for that baptism. So that's what's happening here. And in verse 23, now John was also baptizing in Enon near Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. So John's still the Baptist. He's still continuing his work. Jesus is doing baptism over here, and John's still doing his baptism over here. There's a note about much water. They believe that the place where this was, there was like seven springs, natural springs for people to be baptized. So John is continuing the work which God had called him to do, even though Jesus was in the picture. Verse 24, for John had not yet been thrown into prison. And we touched on this in his background, that John was thrown into prison and later executed. So what this tells us is this is really the last public scene that we get from John the Baptist. This is kind of like John's last hurrah. What's the last thing that we hear from him? Is this section that we're about to get into. And it's kind of like the curtain's closing. And there is another thing when he sends a delegation from jail. But really publicly, as the people then were hearing about John, this was right before the curtain closes, so to speak. And that's what verse 24 is telling us. Hey, look, he hadn't been thrown into prison yet, but it gives us now this scenario in verse 25. There then arose a dispute between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purification. So there arose a dispute regarding purification, and it doesn't say exactly what this dispute was about, but it's a good time right now to clear up baptism and some disputes associated with. There's a good chance that John was being challenged in baptism. And it just seems that wherever baptism, as long as it's been around, there's always been some dispute as to what the right thing, the right way to do it, or how should you do it, and we have disputes today. So what is baptism? So we're talking about John the Baptist. What is baptism? What was he doing? Well, baptism, the word, it just means immersion. So, I mean, if you're washing dishes, you got a pot of water, and you go and you take the sponge, and you put the sponge into the water. You immerse it into the water. That's the picture of baptism, that it's being covered. So, well, what's happening here then? What's happening in the text? What's happening is people are being immersed into water. Why? Why are they? Why? What's the point? The scriptures tell us in the Gospels that this baptism, this immersion into water, was for repentance. Both John and Jesus' disciples were baptizing for repentance. Repentance means that you're going one way and you turn. You stop and turn, you go the other way. That's what repentance means. And so the idea is, hey, I'm going one way, I'm living for myself, but that, no, I'm going to make a public decision for the Lord to draw closer to him, and I'm going to turn and start living for God. And this is what's happening in our text with people coming to be baptized. There was confession involved. The scripture tells us that there was confession. That's a necessary step for repentance, that we confess our sins. And if you're in here this morning and you haven't done that, you haven't given your life over to the Lord, you miss, you know, John 3. I encourage you to read John 3, but it's simple. It's really simple. To be born again, you need to be born again. You need, what is that? What does that mean? What does it mean to be saved? It means to turn from your way to God's way. It's an acknowledgement of your sins, and you confess those sins, and you're asking the Lord to cover those, to be your Savior. The other thing is that this is public. This is a public confession. Baptism is an outward expression of an inward change. And if you are in here and you have been born again, you have turned, you've confessed your sins, and you haven't been baptized, you haven't made that public declaration, you need to. You need to be baptized in obedience. And if, again, that's that outward expression of what's been inwardly done. You could come talk to me. We'll get it set up. You could come talk to Phil, Jason when he gets back. But if you haven't been baptized, you should, to be obedient. We're called to do that. It's that public public expression. Maybe you were baptized, but it was like a sprinkling. Maybe you were baptized before. You didn't know what it meant. You didn't know that it was a picture of that bearing that old life and then rising anew in Christ, that picture of repentance. And you want to, hey, I want to do it again. Those are all great reasons to be baptized. And you come talk with any of the church leaders, and we'll make that happen. That's awesome. It's an awesome thing. Now we come to Verse 26. And they came to John and said to him, Rabbi, hey, he who is with you beyond the Jordan, hey, whom you have testified, behold, he is baptizing and all are coming to him. And as if John the Baptist's disciples are kind of like, hey, whoa. Dude, we're the original OGs here. They're totally like, he's totally stealing the show. Like, what do you mean? This is our kick. Like this is what we do. But he's over there, he's doing that, and notice this verse tells us two things. It tells us that there's a turning of the tide in popularity. John was being used mightily. He was popular, so popular that the religious leaders of the day needed to figure out, they had to address who he was. He was so popular that later on in Jesus' ministry, when they're trying to find a reason to trap Jesus, that they give him this question and about authority, and Jesus goes, hey, John, remember John's baptism? You guys remember that, right? Because everyone knew it. It was very popular. And you remember that, guys? Was that from heaven or was that of man? And it was so popular that the religious leaders of that time were like, hey, we can't say, like, everyone believes that that was from the Lord. We can't say that it wasn't from God. So they ended up going, like, hey, well, we don't know. You know, they kind of played politics right there. But to give you an idea of the effect that they thought they were going to be stoned by the people, the masses, going, what? Like, the outrage. So John was popular. I mean, it was a happening ministry. But we see here that there's a turning of the tide because it says his own disciples go, hey, look, all are now going to him. In chapter 4, there's that acknowledgement that Jesus had baptized and started getting more disciples than John. So it tells us that, boom, things are shifting now. John, who was there to be that voice in the wilderness, to prepare the way for the Lord, has now done that. And now Jesus is taking that popularity. So verse 27 through 30. I believe this is the message that God has for us. That this is the heart that we see in John the Baptist here. That this should be our response in our attitude, in our walks, in our daily lives, in our ministries. Yes, everyone here, if you are saved, you are not saved, and then poof, you're in heaven. You're still here. That means God's not through with you yet. So everyone, if you have a ministry, this is the heart that we're all to have. Let's keep reading. Verse 27, John answered and said, a man can receive nothing unless it has been given to him from heaven. Now, there's two ways to take this, and I think both apply. And we could be encouraged and exhorted by John in both ways. One is maybe John was looking at what he received. And maybe that's our challenge. We look at what we've received, and we hold it having an open hand and a thankful heart versus having a tight grip and an entitled attitude. Well, I deserve this. I should have this. Oh God, you've given this to me, but I'm keeping it. I'm taking it to the end. The Lord has given me just a capacity to do worship. Sometimes I gotta question myself. Is this, he's gifted me with it, but is it for me? You know, should I try and make it big? You know, not that if God's called you to that, then do that. But, you know, in my heart, you know, those gifts, how should I walk? How can I give this gift back to him? Or is it just for me? Is for me to have a position here up on stage? Hey, look at me, I'm on stage. When I think of having this attitude of thankfulness and having an open hand with what the Lord has given us in various seasons and various times, I think about our apartment. A quick story, when my wife and I we were getting married, we both lived in San Jose. But we felt called to come and serve up here in San Mateo and minister to the people up here. And we felt to minister here, we had to be here. We had to be available. And I remember getting our apartment and just being so stoked and so blessed. It was a gift. It was a gift. It was a great deal. It was great. It was just so awesome. And I just remember over time, my opinion of the apartment changed. I'd kind of lost a little bit of that thankfulness, that, oh man, this is so good. And we need to leave. We need to find somewhere else. You know, when the managers changed and the new managers came in and they were a little bit stricter, you know, it's like, oh, you know, we used to be able to, you know. Or there's different neighbors and they're louder, you know, or they drive too fast in, you know, and just various things that had come up and our attitudes had changed regarding the apartment, this apartment. Our family has grown in size. We have, you know, so it's like, oh, it's starting to lose elbow room in that apartment, right? We need somewhere bigger. I feel entitled, you know, maybe looking at other people and, well, we need something bigger. And I'd say in the last 2 years, the Lord's really, really checked both of us in that. And to really reevaluate, hey, remember that was a gift? It still is. And we're still in a season to be thankful for what God has given us there. God has blessed us in so many ways that we can't count there. And it was necessary for us to come and change our attitude regarding that, to be thankful and to make it home again. And I go into that illustration because, you know, there's things in your life. There's people you know that you guys can minister to. There's opportunities that only you have and you may only have in this season. And the Lord has you here, and just to be thankful for those and to hold those with an open hand. Take advantage of what you have. It might be a job. It might be a friendship. It might be a ministry. It might be an ability. I was watching not Special Olympics, what was it? Paralympics, I think it was. My wife had shown me a clip, and it looks exactly like the Olympics with, you know, the big pools, and these guys they're doing their races, they're in their lanes and stuff, but then there's some things that are a little bit different. I mean, these guys are swimming, and they're doing races, and they're swimming way faster than I could swim, but they're blind. And it just made me think of that. Like abilities that we have that we just take for granted. The use of hands, being able to see. And I was just blessed by watching this guy who has lost his sight over the last year, but he didn't let that mar who he was. He was still being all he could be, so to speak. And that's the heart that we should have before and after we have some abilities. Maybe the Lord is calling you guys to something. Maybe he's been stirring something up in you. You have to ask that. You have to be listening to the Lord. I can't tell you what that is. Ask yourself, what is that thing to be thankful for? So that's one way to take that. The other way that maybe John responded is, maybe he was looking at what others had received. And he was looking at his attitude towards that. And he's like, hey, well, look, a man can receive nothing unless it is given to him from heaven. Maybe he was looking at Jesus. He was like, hey, look what he's received. I didn't give that to him. I mean, God gave that to him. Who am I? What, I'm going to go against God? I'm going to be jealous of what God is doing in that person's life? And sometimes we can fall into that trap. That's a trap where we start, instead of looking up and putting our eyes on the Lord, we start looking side to side. And like, well, what do they have? Well, what are they doing? And we start kind of viewing our Christianity, our walk, where we are in life, and we get into this compare mode. Oh, they got a new phone? Well, right? We got to get the next one, right? We got to get a new phone. Yeah. Oh, they moved in here? I work in a really interesting area. It's in Pacific Heights in San Francisco. There's a lot of money there. I mean, millionaires, billionaires. These houses are amazing. They're mansions. And sometimes I get the idea, I get a picture into the heart of mankind. Sometimes I look and I just feel like, well, I'll walk into this place that someone had just bought and it's beautiful. It's amazing. It's beautiful. It's like, can I live in the guest house? Like, this is awesome. And I show up and I talk with the guy and the guy's like, yeah, we're getting rid of all of it. It's all getting trashed, demolished. And I'm like, what? It's amazing. We're getting rid of all this? Yeah. Owner wants new finishes. Wanted to put his stamp in it. And it's just like, I get the sense that there's kind of like, they're remodeling. Okay, we're remodeling. It's good for me. Hey, I got a job because of it. But you know, I get that feeling sometimes, that's what's in the heart of man. Sometimes we can fall into that trap and start comparing. And don't do that. John didn't do that. He's like, Lord's given him his deal. I got mine. And ultimately, when I'm dead and I'm standing before the Lord, I'm not going to be held accountable for what he did. God's not going to ask me about the gifts that were given to somebody else. It's going to be, hey, what did you do with what I gave you? And I know we all want to hear, enter in, well done, good and faithful servant. That's what we want to hear when we meet the Lord. Verse 28 and 29, John continues his response, and we get a look into his heart. Hey, you yourselves bear witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is fulfilled. John's like, I'm not the guy. You've heard me say, I am not the guy. They asked me, are you Elijah? Are you the Christ? No, I'm not the guy. He's the guy. John's heart was there to glorify. He had a heart that wanted to glorify the guy, Christ. He had a heart that wanted to glorify Christ. He had a heart that said, look, it's not about me. To give you a picture of this attitude, sometimes, and I've noticed this a couple times, and it's a good stop sign for me, but sometimes in the morning, we're getting ready, and we're all going to go somewhere, right? With, I don't know, school, vacation, whatever. And I get up. I gotta get ready. Boom, shower, put my clothes on, everything. Get my coffee, eat. All right, I'm ready to go out the door. Let's go, babe. It's my wife, Jasmine, over there. Yeah, babe. Why aren't you ready? I look over and she's like still in sweats, you know. And she's like, I've been getting the kids ready. I've been making you breakfast. Yeah, I'm not ready yet. I've been doing stuff for you. And that's just a good picture to me of being like waking up and having this centered attitude on me versus waking up and having this centered attitude on others. And I'm challenged by that. I'm really blessed by that, my wife, that she's such a servant. But all of us, I mean, we see that in John. John, what? It's not about me. I'm just the best man. And he was the best man, by the way. The best man is an awesome title. Among those born among women, none are greater than John the Baptist. I mean, he was the best man. He was pretty awesome. But the wedding is not a wedding for the best man. It's for the bride, which is the church, and the bridegroom, which is Jesus. So do we have that heart? Are we challenged on that? Paul says, I die daily. Crucify the flesh. Do we wake up like that? I'm preaching to myself. I confess, and I don't always have that Christ-centered attitude. Do you? Do you wake up? God. I remember I had a youth pastor that said whenever he woke up, before he put his feet on the floor, he woke up and he said, yes, Lord. That's always stuck with me. It's not part of my habits yet. But I pass it on to you to be encouraged by it as well. Before the day goes on, to have that heart, start to align in, God, what are you longing to do through me today? Fill me with your love. Fill me with your spirit before I get going. And finally, verse 30, he must increase and I must decrease. The constant prayer, the constant cry of our hearts. Do you have that heart in you? And if you do, how? How do we do that? How do we live in such a way that Christ is increasing and that we are decreasing? There's two things. One, for Christ to increase in us, we need to draw near to him. The more time you spend with the Lord, the more you're going to be like him. It's kind of like in your group of friends, you're with that group of friends, they rub off on you. That's just how it is. People rub off on people. Think about who you're hanging out with school. Pick your friends wisely. But above all, pick Christ. Make Christ your friend. Spend time with him. And as you spend time with him, you're going to become like him because you're with him. And second is to walk in the Spirit. Galatians, it's a great book, great epistle, says to walk in the Spirit. You will not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. You know those desires that you have innate, those selfish desires that you have innate in you, where you want to do things, your self-centeredness. Hey, if you walk in the Spirit, you will not give in to those. That they're at war with one another. And that you go not in your own strength. Look, if you, let's say, if you're here and you are saved, you've been born again. You've made that confession. There's a spiritual work that's been done in you through belief. God has started a work and he's put his Holy Spirit in you. And if that's happened, this spiritual way in which we've started, we're then going to be made perfect and more like Jesus through our flesh, through our own human willpower? No. As a matter of fact, that's what Paul says in Galatians. He goes, hey, you guys started in the Spirit. You're going to be made perfect in the flesh? It's not going to happen. Let's just flip over to Galatians real quick. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. And then we get a list of what the flesh looks like. And in verse 22, there's that contrast. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such, there is no law. And those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Don't try and walk in your own strength. Rely on the Lord. You will fail. God will not fail. Amen? Verses 31 through 36, John the Baptist, he reveals his heart to us, but then he goes into this. He takes a step back, and he kind of surveys the situation, and that's where we get these last verses. I'm going to highlight just a couple things here. Phil, how much time do we have? 15. Verse 31, he who comes from above is above all, and he who is of earth is earthly and speaks of the earth. He who comes from heaven is above all. And what he has seen and heard, he testifies that no one receives his testimony. Verse 33, he who has received his testimony has certified that God is true. For he whom God has sent speaks, that's Jesus, speaks the words of God. For God does not give the Spirit by measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. And he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life. Why? Because the wrath of God already abides on him. That's that state. So just some things to highlight in this last couple things. In this last section, the heavenly message given through the Son and in the Son is Jesus himself. Jesus is that picture of heaven. Maybe you've thought, oh, I want to know what God thinks. I want to know what he cares about. I want to know more about God. Maybe you've thought that. What is God like? What is God like? Well, Hebrews chapter 1 tells us that the Son is the perfect message that God is. that he's shouting, who the Son is that message that he's shouting to the world. John 1:18, John the Baptist, or John 1:18 says, hey, you haven't seen God at any time, but in him you see the Son. And he's declared the Son to you. John 1:1, the apostle, he talks about the gospel and that Jesus being the Word, being God, and from the beginning, and becoming flesh and dwelling among us. Jesus states himself in John 10, I and my Father are one. He is in me, and I am in him. You guys want to know what God is like? You want to know who he is, what he cares about? Know the Son. Know Jesus Christ. There's no clearer picture than the Son of God. If you're ever wondering, what is God saying? There is no clearer picture than Jesus. And to touch on in verse 36, John affirms the same message that Jesus gave earlier in the chapter. That verse 36, he who believes in the Son has everlasting life. That salvation is through belief. Belief in who? The Son. And he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. Just that straight up condition that there's judgment upon us, upon all mankind naturally. We're born this way. But praise God that the invitation is so universal, whosoever. So, concluding, in light of all that we have, in light of what Jason has said in Ephesians, talked about Ephesians 2:10, that there are good works that you are to walk in, that you are his workmanship, that God has a season and times for you, good things prepared for you before the foundation of the world. In light of the epistles to the Romans and to the Corinthians, that there's a variety of gifts and talents, that we're one body to be working together, that we need each other, that the Lord has made us that way, that he is the head and we are the body, and every part of the body functions and has a purpose. That Peter's epistle, he says that there are different gifts and different ministries, but that each has received one. As each one has received a special gift, employing it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Just going there real quick, I want to read that next verse. Verse 11 says, so if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it with the ability which God supplies. And in all things, God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom we belong, and the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So in light of these things that we've received, that God has done for us, that God has for us, is prepared for us, what are we going to do? Check your heart. It's not just about what you do. It's also about your heart. And we see that in John. In whatever season it is that we keep John's heart, that we could be thankful, that we could be helpful and not jealous, that we could be humble and Christ have a Christ-centered attitude, that we could be seeking him, that we could be walking in his Spirit, and that we could be realistic, that we could take some steps back. Look, it's not about us. I'm earthly, but God, he has a heavenly view. That's realistic, that God sees things that we don't. That's real. It's true. What has God been moving on your heart? Ask yourself, we have a time of communion coming up, time of worship. It's a great time. As you come and you take communion, communion's for believers. If you're not a believer, become one. It's really easy. Grab someone and say, hey, I want Jesus. Anybody. It's really easy. But if you don't want to do that, if you can't do that in good conscience right now, then don't. But don't take communion. But for the rest of us, you come taking communion. It's a great time. It's a great time to spend time with the Lord, to be challenged by Him, to be exhorted. God, what are you doing? What are you to have me do in this season right now? Worship team can come up. Let's pray. Lord, you are good. You are good. You are good, and your love endures forever. Lord, you have reached down from heaven, Lord, and you have touched us. Lord, we're so thankful to be here, to be called your sons and your daughters, to be used by you, Lord, that you use us, Lord, that you're mindful of us, that you bless us. Lord, in all of our flaws, our failures, Lord, that you lift us up. You are a good God. You are a great God. Holiness be what we long for. Righteousness be what we long for. That faithfulness be what we long for. That brokenness be broken before you. What we long for. Lord, take our heart and form it. Lord, take our minds and transform it. Take our will and conform it to your Son. We thank you for this time of worship, Lord. We ask that you speak to us. Fill us with your Spirit, Lord. And if there's anything that I've said, Lord, that, Lord, does not ring of your grace, Lord, I pray that you just remove it from the minds. But, Lord, that your grace, your voice, Lord, would move. That your voice would move us, just as John was there to prepare the way, Lord, that we would have that heart. That people would see you in us as we draw near to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Death is but a man. Its grip on me. I am yours, I belong to thee. Though temptations may come my way, though fear may rise in trouble's day, save, and we call upon.
sin, Jesus is calling. Come to the end of yourself. Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Come to the altar. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born. Precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Sorrows a trade of joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born.
Sing, oh, what a Savior.
Oh, what Living water rain down on me. Lord, I need more of you. Living breath of life, come and fill me up. We are hungry, we are hungry, we are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus, we are thirsty for more of you. Higher and higher and higher to you. lift our empty hands up. Lord, we want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher and higher to you. We are hungry, we are hungry, we are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. Lord Jesus, what a beautiful picture you paint for us, God. That you would lay down your life for us. That you would sacrifice for us. You would be our sacrifice. And Lord, we are just like John the Baptist. We don't have a different calling. You've called us to go out into the wilderness and proclaim your name and to prepare the way of the Lord. God, give us boldness. Give us courage, God, that we would do that. That we would not stand idly by and watch people hurting and broken, needing hope. Father, may we give them that hope and share that with them. May we be those beacons of light on a hill in the stormy, stormy sea, that they would see you, God, that they would see you. Father, take our hearts, Lord Jesus. Take our lives, God. Increase in us, God, that there would be no room left for our flesh and our sin and our desires of the flesh. God, may we long for heavenly things. May we long for spiritual things, God, that we may be your children and do your work while we're here, Lord Jesus, on this earth. May our love for you outshine our longing for the things of the world, God. Take your rightful place in our lives, Jesus. Be first, God. And we ask, Lord Jesus, that we would have a better understanding of who you are, God, by reading your scriptures, by spending time with you, by making time for you, God. May we not start our day or end our day with thoughts of tomorrow or thoughts of the to-do list, but God, may we start and end it with you on our mind, God, on our hearts, Lord Jesus. Father, touch us with your spirit, God, and fill us, fall afresh on us, Jesus. We ask, Lord Jesus, that we would be fruitful, God, that we would bear fruit for you, God. So take us, Lord. Take us, Jesus. We are your servants, God, and we want to be used by you, Lord Jesus. Touch us at our schools, at our workplaces, at our homes, God. May church not be the only place where we feel your presence, God. But may we feel your presence with us everywhere we go, because you have promised your spirit to us, God. Father, breathe new life in our lungs, Jesus. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. We thank you for the privilege that we have to come together and to raise your name high. We are on a hill right now, Lord Jesus, and we are lifting up the praises of your name, God, and we are magnifying you. Your word is being taught and shared and spoken. Lord Jesus, we do not take that for granted, Lord Jesus, the freedom that we have right now in you. So, God, touch us, Jesus. May we be like a good disease in our areas, Lord Jesus, that it would just be a chain reaction and everybody would be touched by you, God. Have your way in us, Lord. Have your way in us. We praise you, God. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You guys are good to go.